That's a long time.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, except that we don't have a woman today. You know, when they want to press me, we're just two tough men. Thank you for having me.
It's good to have you here. Well, you called for suspension of campaign activities, and you provided the lead in that regard. And you visited some parts of the country, Anambra East, Anambra West. Okay, what has been your experience? And what do you say to the allegation by some of your critics that you have been given only, is it 24 or 12 loaves of bread? And that you have been stingy in providing support. Can you tell us how many loaves of bread that you provided and what your experience has been, you know, on your tours?
Ruben, thank God we're able to laugh today. I can tell you what Nigeria is going today in terms of this flooding is far, far more devastating than we since. For those of us who haven't experienced it, Ruben, I was part of the 2012 flooding. This is far more than 2012. You can even see it in death. In 2012, about 300 and something people died. And of course, the lands and everything that have been devastated, this is far worse. It's huge. The entire Bayelsa, for example, apart from maybe government house and a few facilities, is under the water. Similar situation in some parts of Delta, in some parts of rivers, in some parts, you can go on and on and on. Over 2,000 homes are under the water. And of course, millions of people are displaced, and their IDP camps, and of course, children out of school, is something you cannot imagine, and everything. So for me, I don't even think it was not just stopping campaign. What I saw is far more than I can imagine. In terms of donation or bread, providing bread, I've never provided any food, be it one bread, to anything. Whatever you must have seen is what people brought on their own to where I visited. What I've known is to ask those who are involved or areas where I've went, I've asked the state or anybody that is coordinating them to give me a bank account so I can help. But what I find in some of the IDP camps is that when I was going around and talking to the people who are there, they will tell you that they don't even have one naira. So what I've done immediately, I say, okay, how many people are here? And they will say there are 2,000 or 3,000, the case may be. I can say, okay, why don't you give them this 2 million or 3 million or 5 million so they can just share so that people can have, even if it's one naira. Some of them were begging me, sir, give us 100 naira so we can also, because the government are struggling to feed them, but nobody's giving them even one naira. So I'm going to contribute. Ruben, I've been involved in this type of service far before I became governor. And you know yourself very well that in 2012, I came to Jonathan and said I was going to aid when they had an earthquake, and he said, what are you going here to do? I said, that's what I've done all my life, that I and my family have been involved in such situations all over the world. While we were still talking, I told him, I showed him my son's, is that I withdrew my son in school. We were going to Haiti. I went to Haiti. The ambassador then will tell you, police people there will tell you, that's us in Haiti. And my son that I withdrew from school. We were there for a week, and I was serving governor. So it's not just that today I started doing this. You must intervene. That is the purpose. In Nigeria, the situation is hopeless. If anything Nigeria is supposed to be doing now is dealing with this issue.
All right. And that's why the call for, you know, ceasing of campaign is germane at this point, and other candidates who, you know, I've responded, donated, and things like that. But let's go straight to it. Two things. Number one will be, what will be your solution to the climate change problem? Because this, yes, there's climate change. There's also the dam problem. And that dam problem, too, that we've not done to embark for Lado is also a problem that once Lado was opened, this was affected. And secondly, there's been talk about ecological funds. And I'd like to ask you, you know, while you were governor, what did you do with your own ecological funds? And coupled with the fact that you were also governor in a state that after you left in 2017, Onitsha was said to be one of the most polluted cities in the world. In fact, it had 10 PMS, particulate matters. You know, so let's talk about that.
Well, let me start by my own... I'll start with what you asked about Onitsha. You can go and ask Professor Folade of UN Habitat. I was the first governor ever in Nigeria to approach UN Habitat on urban renewal because of Onitsha. Followed it through by visiting the UN Habitat office in Kenya for them to help us to redesign and do the urban renewal of Onitsha, Newi, and Oka. It's a clear study. UN Habitat is there. They listen to what I'm saying. I followed it through. On issue of ecological fund and everything, go and read, and I'll forward it to you today, who is the chief architect of NUMAP, which is what they are doing today. It was me who went to President Yar'Adua and told him that the federal government cannot fund erosion menace in Nigeria, especially in the southeast. That the only way to do it is to bring a long-term loan from federal government, from World Bank, with federal government contribution and the state contribution to deal with this issue. That was how NUMAP was designed. Between me, John Ode, the governors of the Southeast, the NUMAP you're seeing today, and I'll show you the records. So that I've been involved in all this. I've always believed, yes, there might be, somebody can say, oh, your house is still very dirty, but they don't know how you met it and what you have been able to clean. But like I said, go and verify these two things I said today. My involvement with UN Habitat, how we went to Kenya, who was the first governor to do this. Go and look at the records of the NUMAP. I'll show you later from the ministry, signed by John Ode. You see my contribution to the NUMAP, which is what everybody is using today to be able to fight the ecological fund and everything. And what will I do in terms of this menace to stop this flooding? There's a combination of so many things that you need to do. You're talking about the issue of on dam. We showed the issue, even the minister said it's the rainfall, it's not the dam issue. But if you take the average rainfall in the past 20 years, since 2001, it's remained similar, which means it's predictable the amount of flood that is going to come. But the issue is that you have refused to dredge your rivers. You need to dredge River Benue, you need to dredge River Niger. If you do River Niger and from Barrow in Niger State down to the Atlantic Ocean and everything, so your water is silted. So you find out that there's no ability to hold drainage. And of course, the tributaries and everything is part of what is causing this menace. And the rivers are no longer contributing to your economic growth as it should be, because you've not done anything. And we find a lot of contrasts. Several contracts have been awarded to this dredge, which nobody knows where it is or what has happened to it. These are things you need to do to be able to contain this. We have these two rivers put together. For example, if we do this, we'll be able, from one of the studies, even at the to me recently, and what Navarro showed me, it will be able to contribute one River Nile is contributing to Egypt. And River Nile is about 600 I think it's 6,650
kilometers
long.
I'll verify.
You know, if you look at it, I'm sure Niger, I think, is about 4,000 plus, and the River Benue is about 1,400. These two put together is at least 1,000 short of the length of River Nile.
Nile is 6,650 kilometers.
So you can see it. And Niger, I think, is 4,184, something like that. So if you combine these two, that's up to River Nile. If Egypt can keep Nile dredging it, silting it, making it work, contributing to the economy and everything, tourism and everything, why can't we do this over several years? So these are things we need to do. You know, these are things where I will start ensuring that if we award the contract, we're not going to do it overnight, that at least it is working. If we have been doing it, if you drive in the dry season over River Niger, which I drive every day, you could see that you can even walk on the river. So it's something that is solvable.
Okay, Mr. Peter Obi, you recall that popular saying, you are referring to River Nile. They say, no Nile, no Egypt. Mm-hmm. That's how strategic.
That's what it should be. No Niger, no.
Yes.
No Benue.
But I want to ask you, before you joined us, we were talking about the manifesto of the All Progressives Congress and Ashu Ajibola Ahmed Tinubu. And I made a comment that all of you presidential candidates, you say the same things. Security, economy, I will build infrastructure, I will create jobs. No, we are not dumb. We know, you know, everybody's just saying the same thing all over the place. And we keep asking the question that if there's any lesson we should learn from what has happened in Great Britain, it's about how do you do it? A whole prime minister has spent less than 50 days because she couldn't figure out how to do it. She and her chancellor, they're out. Even Boris Johnson, that in Nigerian terms would easily have been headed back to office. I said, no. It looks like this matter has gone past, the elbow. So what is the difference, really? You know, how are you different from the other candidates? Because all of you seem to be saying the same things.
Ruben, all of us are saying the same thing. I said it repeatedly. What makes a difference in this is who can we trust? This election is about is trust. You are promising the same thing. Rufai is promising the same thing. Can we look at the antecedents of Rufai? Things he has promised in the past. How he delivered it. Or attempted to deliver it. He must have attempted to do it. Who do we trust among these people? Who among these people can we say have the character, the competence, the capacity, the commitment to at least do what he is, he or she is saying? That is what differentiates us. It's not people who have promised in the past. We've had promises that our dollar was going to be 1-to-1. Now we are almost 800-to-1, and nobody's saying anything. We've had promises where we are told agriculture is going to be this. The things I'm promising, and that is why, Ruben, I keep saying, we do not need, you know, all this fanciful, very good-looking manifestos or documents that are written. Let the people come and talk. You mentioned about Britain. What main result is not because, it's because what he promised he cannot deliver. Unhonorably, he pack a suitcase and everything and go out because you cannot deliver what you promised. Everything fell apart. And they're not looking at her background. So within a few years, Britain have had Boris Johnson, who is a Turkish descent. They've had somebody from British descent. They're not going to have somebody from Indian descent. They're not asking about their background. They're not asking about what they go. They're asking about their competence, their capacity, what they can do. What this man promised. I was speaking to a colleague of mine yesterday when this started, because of course you know it yourself, and you've Googled, you and Alumina have voice for you. Google now, and they will show you. I was speaking to somebody that I'm very close to yesterday in the UK. And I said, what do you think? He said, listen, as far as we are concerned, we don't care if the man is a Nigerian or Ghanaian or anything. We want to save Britain. We care about the future of Britain. We care about our economy. We care about this. If it's Nigerian, and they'll be talking about his ethnicity, about his religion, about his this and everything, or whether he has a glossy manifesto and everything. Like you said, come and tell us what you do, how you do it. And don't come and tell us through a spokesperson, because this is the only place people are campaigning through people. It doesn't happen anywhere. Obama will come and say what you say. Sunak will soon start telling people what he will say. Everybody's talking with his mouth, so people can take note. Here they will bring spokesperson who will come and say, then when they go in, they say, it wasn't me who said this, it was my party who said it, it was this.
Okay.
I want people to face, like I come to you. Let people come, Ruben, whatever I say, tape it. If I go and I cannot do it, I go home like this trust. Nobody's name is president or governor or anything.
Okay. But the manifesto is a social contract. Even this Sunak you're talking about, UK and everybody, if I go to Labour Party or Conservative Party's website now, I will see, the first thing I will see there is their manifesto and how they're going to do it. We can check it. We can go to the party's website now. So why is it that you have not given us yet your manifesto as a social contract?
Secondly,
something happened recently that a lot of people say we must ask you. Your vice presidential candidate said on a TV interview that the fact that people, that NSAS, there was a massacre, is debatable. What do you say as regards that after Lagos Panel of Inquiry released a report to that effect?
Well, you know, I've, Rufai, I didn't even listen to that. Maybe I'll go back and listen to it, I must tell you. I didn't listen to it, I'm just hearing it for the first time and everything. And for me, there are things that we need to probably open up tomorrow and look into. I can assure you, I've always said, in my reconciliation, we must go back to certain things and be able to open it up. Apologize to people because things were done wrongly. There's so many things that we need to apologize for in this country.
So is it fair for your vice presidential candidate to apologize to Nigerians?
It is me.
For saying
it is me. I'm the president.
Okay, so you want to apologize on behalf of your vice president?
No, I'm not apologizing. I said there's so many things. I will apologize. I will apologize to Niger Delta people, the way they've been treated. Where you can say, the first place we found oil in Nigeria, you can't go there today. You can't live there today. There's so many things to apologize here. If we're going to move forward, and I'm going to do that. And I did it. When I returned school to the churches, I called the church owners. I said, on behalf of this state, we did something wrong to have taken you as assets. Please, I apologize. Help us to build a good education facility and let's manage it. And within 1, 2, 3 years, we were number one. So there's things to apologize.
What's your read on NSAS? Were people killed? Because if your vice president says debate, were people
for me,
killed?
Was there a massacre? I said, I'll deal with that issue and I can deal with it when I come in.
Well, Mr.
That's what.
I need to come in here.